All right, so let's look at some of these applications of using the psychrometric chart. So what I'm going to be doing here is just developing equations for a couple different scenarios, applications. And then when we get to the example, you'll start to see how we can tweak these so that we can use the chart in an effective way. Now, all these ones I'm looking at are all in the handout, done out completely. So definitely look there. Here I'm just going to go over some of the basics on the highlight side of things. So conservation of mass wise, if we look at this, we have the mass flow rate of air. Because it's not condensing all, it's going to be the same mass flow rate in and out, so that's constant the whole way through. We have this mass flow rate of vapor that goes in, and then we're going to have some liquid or vapor that comes in this air conditioning system. And so then the mass flow rate of vapor on the way out is a summation of the two mass flow rates. All right, so but on the energy side, let's look at the energy equation. We have this is steady state, so zero and there on the left-hand side. We have some Q dot of our control volume. Plus, we have coming in, this moist air coming in at state one, we have the mass flow rate of air times the enthalpy of air at state one, plus the mass flow rate of the vapor at state one times the enthalpy of the vapor at state one. And we're going to add in this mass flow rate of the water. So we've got mass flow rate of water times enthalpy of water coming in there minus the mass flow rate of the enthalpy of air, or the mass flow rate of air times the enthalpy of air at state 2 plus the mass flow rate of the vapor at state 2 times the enthalpy of the vapor at state 2. All right, so after we do our substitutions now, this becomes, it's still our Q dot of the control volume, plus, and let's bring out the mass flow rate of the air, and we'll get the enthalpy of the air at state 1 minus the enthalpy of air at state 2 plus the humidity ratio at state 1 times the saturated vapor value at state 1 plus the humidity ratio at state 2 minus the humidity ratio at state 1. I'll multiply by the molecular weight of the water minus the humidity ratio at state 2 times the saturated vapor value at state 2. All right, so where do all these values come from? So let's look at here. So we got the air. So this is one came down from here. And we had this other air value came from over in the other equation, or for the exiting moist air. For the vapor here, so the vapor that's coming in, that one shows up, oops, I went too far there. That one shows up right here. And then for the mass of the water that's entering, that's what this humidity ratio difference is between the two. And then we have the enthalpy value there. And then for the enthalpy and mass of the vapor, they show up when that humidity ratio as well as enthalpy of saturation. All right, so you can see where all those go in that equation. So we'll be using something similar to this as well as the others that you'll see here in solving the example as well as other problems that we'll use in psychrometrics here. Also note from the handout is that because we have this delta H here, right, just like I did when solving the adiabatic saturator back when we were looking at an equation for the humidity ratio, we can substitute here because of small temperature differences we typically deal with. This is Cp delta T. All right, so we can substitute for that and make that a little bit easier on ourselves. So let's look at a dehumidification process. This is if we would have a dehumidifier in our house, we'd have some moist air coming in. All right, so some mass flow rate of air, some humidity ratio, and this is all happening at one atmosphere. So this moist air would come in, and it would hit this cooling coil. Right, and this cooling coil would cool it until it hits the dew point, right, and then we'd get some moisture that comes out, some condensate, right, so it comes some condensate at some T2, and then what we have that would go on the rest of the way, right, would be at this lower temperature, some temperature lower than the entrance temperature, but it would be completely saturated, the humidity ratio, or relative humidity, but 100%, and because we lost some vapor from the air, our humidity ratio would be smaller here at state 2 than it was at state 1. All right, so this analysis is what I'm going to do below down here. But I want to show you the rest of this here. We're going to do then the heating coil, then basically heats it back up. So we're back up to close to the temperature we came up at T1 because we cooled it off. So let's look at what happens over here on our psychrometric chart. So we start off here. We have some initial humidity ratio, relative humidity and humidity ratio, all right, at state one. We come in. And what we do is we're going to cool this, right? This is a cooling coil. So we're going to cool based on this dry bulb temperature. It's cooling. It's going to a smaller and smaller dry bulb temperature and still until it hits the dew point, right? Once it hits the dew point, it's going to continue to cool. It's going to continue to cool while it's here at this temperature at 2, right? Wherever this cooling coil is at. So we'll continue to cool. And as we cool, we're producing condensate. So that's why all this stuff is forming. Because we're running along this line, we're continuing to cool until we get to our final temperature. We actually cool to that temperature. Once we cool to that temperature, we would just go ahead and exit, and we'd be at 100% relative humidity, right? At some lower humidity ratio. We lost vapor from the air, but the amount of air stayed the same. So that's why the humidity ratio would go down, right? We then go from 2 to 3 because we want to warm things back up. Here, we're originally at T2, and we want to warm things back up. As we warm things back up, we're going to stay at a constant humidity ratio. We're not going to add any more or lose any more vapor. So it's a constant humidity ratio. And as we heat things up, we'll see that our relative humidity goes down. Right? The relative humidity is decreasing from 100% down to, I don't know, 60% or whatever it may be on that chart. All right, so that's what's actually happening in that process. So from an energy perspective, we have, again, it's steady state. So we have zero. I'll just keep it in blue here. Zero equals... We have M dot R, which is our water that's going here through the cooling coil. So that's we have M dot, and we have the H inlet, enthalpy coming in, minus the enthalpy at the exit. So again, we're looking at all the terms that are in this control volume, right? Let me just get in a better color here. All right, everything inside. Oh, I wanted a different color there. Hang on. All right, so everything inside this control volume right there. All right, so that's the control volume we're looking at here. All right, so we have the enthalpies of the refrigerant that's going in, hence the R, plus everything coming in at state one. So we got the mass flow rate of air times enthalpy of air at state one, plus the mass flow rate of the vapor at state one times enthalpy of the vapor at state one. So notice in pretty much all these cases, I can't think of a case when we wouldn't, but the mass flow rate of the air is going to be constant. It's just not going to condense out like the vapor is. So that's going to be pretty much constant all the way through our process. All right, so that's everything coming at state one minus the mass flow rate of the water that's leaving along with its enthalpy, and then minus the other part that's leaving, which is our moist air at the exit, which is mass flow rate of air times the enthalpy of the air at state 2 plus the mass flow rate of the vapor at state 2 times enthalpy of the vapor at state 2. All right, so again, this is all happening right within this box here. It does not include the heating coil. That's what that process is shown from 2 to 3, leaving the actual dehumidifier and then reheating as it exits here. But all this down here in my equation is just looking at what's happening in this control volume here. All right. So that's dehumidification. Now let's look at humidification. So instead of taking moisture out of the air, we're going to put moisture into the air. And so what it looks like generically, you know, with our control volume over here, we have some moisture coming in. We're going to inject some water. It either could be vapor or it can be in the liquid phase. And then we have our moist air coming out. And you can see it's going to have a higher humidity ratio because we're adding vapor to the air. To our moist air, not taking it out. So it's going to be greater than what comes in. Now how that looks over here on our psychrometric chart, if we inject steam, all right, we're going to increase the humidity ratio. All right, so you can see the humidity ratio increasing from whatever we had at 1 to 2. So we're increasing the humidity ratio. We're also going to increase the temperature. Right, if you're injecting steam, unless it's a very, very hot mixture, like superheated steam, we're going to inject cooler steam, but... typical case that we're actually doing humidification, we're going to inject steam, so it's hotter than our moist air. We'll see the dry bulb temperature increase. And because we're doing humidification, we're going to see the relative humidity increase from whatever it was down here to something closer to the 100% relative humidity line, which is up here. So that's what's steam injected. If we have liquid injected for our humidification, we're going to see a decrease in temperature. All right, and we'll see still see an increase in the humidity ratio and an increase in the relative humidity because we're getting closer to our 100% relative humidity line. Right, but we're going to see that decrease in temperature due to the liquid injection. So that's humidification. For evaporative cooling, this is more valuable to use when we're in more drier climates where things readily evaporate. But what we have here is we have our moisture coming in, and we either have a soak pad or we could have something where we're spraying vapor into the air just so it quickly evaporates, and the energy that it takes to evaporate helps to drop the temperature. So the temperature exiting T2 is less than our entering temperature T1. All right. So the also see the it looks like it's the liquid aspect from humidification. So we're going to drop in temperature, which is the whole point of cooling. But we'll also see an increase in the relative humidity as well as the humidity ratio because we are adding vapor to the air. So on an energy basis, we got we're going to have the enthalpy of the air at state 2 plus the humidity ratio at state 2 times enthalpy of the saturated vapor at state 2. That's all going to equal. What we have exiting is going to equal that the change in humidity ratios, which represents the water that's needed to be added, plus the initial energy we have coming in at state 1. Oops, that's a really big number one. All right, and the thing I want to highlight about this, though, is this part right here. Notice this guy and this guy. All right, that's the mixture enthalpy per unit mass of dry air. That's where this value comes in really handy, picking stuff along this line on the psychrometric chart. So for evaporative cooling, as well as the other cases, if you can get stuff in this form, it'll help us solve things a little bit more quickly. So look for that in the example problem. So finally, we have here is adiabatic mixing, putting together two moist air streams. So this is an all completely insulated process. And so we have some mass flow rate of air, temperature, and a humidity ratio. Same thing for the another stream coming in at state 2. And then we have the mixture that comes out at state 3. So this stuff we kind of already done with the ideal gas mixture processes. We're just doing this with air, dry air, and water vapor. All right, so the energy balance for this is relatively straightforward. We have the mass flow rate of air at state 1 times that mixture enthalpy value. So we have the enthalpy of the air times the humidity ratio times the saturated humidity, or humidity at the saturation conditions, plus the mass flow rate of air at state 2 times the mixture enthalpy again. And that's all going to equal what we have coming out at state 3. So again, check out what we have on the handout. A lot of these equations are already there, a little bit more development as well. But we'll go ahead and do an example problem, and hope this that was helpful, kind of continuing to push through and looking at where psychrometrics show up in everyday life.